Welcome to Freedive Live with Ted Hardy, episode number 29. So obviously my name is Ted Hardy. I'm the founder of Immersion Freediving as well as freedivingsafety.com. I've been a full-time instructor with performance freediving since 2009, and I'm also a competitive freediver as well. So for those of you that are new to the show, haven't seen the show before, wondering what the heck this is, basically the way the show works is I take one entertaining educational story from my career, and then I pick one topic to discuss in depth, and then I answer your questions live at the end of the show. I'd also like to say a special thank you to the folks at Noob Spiro. This show is airing on the Noob Spiro page tonight for the first time, or over there, probably tomorrow morning. For the first time, if you're not familiar with them, they're a spearfishing podcast out of Australia. They're tons of fun. They're hilarious. So basically, if you like spearfishing and you like podcasts, you should go check out Noob Spiro. They've got a great podcast. And they have excellent choice in guests because they've had me on the show twice. So if you guys have not visited or not familiar with freedivingsafety.com, let me explain what it is. Right? So freedivingsafety.com is a free online course that goes over the risks of the sport, the truth about blackout, the truth about the fatality numbers. And you can learn a lot of things such as how to tell if you're overweighted, how to tell if you're breathing in such a way that would increase your risk of blackout, what you actually see, what is a loss of motor control, what does a blackout actually look like, and most importantly, what are you supposed to do if your buddy has a loss of motor control or a blackout, right? So you're going all of that at the course, and it's free. Right? If that's not enough reason to visit, I also try to bribe you. If you go through the program and you pass the quiz, you're going to get an email at the end, assuming you pass the quiz, with discounts from 9 of the biggest names in the sport, right? So learn to save yourself, learn to save your buddy, or save some money. Either way, there's no reason not to visit freedivingsafety.com. So for today's show, game plan is going to be, I'm going to be telling the story of how I almost talked myself off the Discovery Channel. I ended up getting on the Discovery Channel, and I worked really hard to talk myself off that show until Kathy slapped me around. I'll be discussing in-depth about a lung squeeze, what it is, what does it look like, how to tell if you've got one, what to do if you get one, and then I'll be answering your questions live at the end. So as always, for those that are watching, if you have questions for me, the best thing you can do is put those in the comments. And I will, I won't answer them as soon as you put them in there, but I answer them at the end of this show. So for those of you that are watching, I'm always curious, where you're from, and are you a spear fisherman or more of a recreational freediver or a bit of both, right? Always just curious about how the, who the folks listening, what the audience is like. I'm going to check one thing real quick. Bear with me, guys. Let me take 1 second. All right, cool. All right. So mine actually, I just looked at it today. So my most popular course is the one right there, right? Is the onlinefreedivingcourses.com. And it's got it's got a couple courses on there. But the most popular course is my how to increase your bottom time by taking a bigger breath, right? I'll show you what it looks like. so, oh no, I don't want to see that. I don't want to see me. I want to see this. Okay, so the most popular course I have is that is this course right here, right? I just looked today. I've had 1,000 people sign up for this course. So this is how to, whether you're a spear fisherman or a competitive freediver, what it is, whatever kind of freediving you do, we all want to spend more time underwater. And what this course is going to do is teach you how to take a bigger breath. So you just go to the website and just type in your name and email address, hit get this now, and then boom, you're going to get it. So basically, this is one of the first things I teach my students in this class is how to take a 20 to 30% bigger breath. And it's just like a car, right? If you put more fuel in a car, it's going to go farther. If you're a free diver, I don't care what kind of free diving you do, we all want more time down there. So one of the simplest ways to get that time is take down more fuel. And that's what the course teaches you, and it's free. And you can get it right there at onlinefreedivingcourses.com. Okay, so so this is the story of how I almost talked myself off the Discovery Channel. So there was, I guess it was the beginning of this year, January, February, I appeared on the Discovery Channel for a show called Hard to Kill with Tim Kennedy. So Tim Kennedy is a U.S. Ranger. He was a UFC fighter. He's a sniper. He did the show Killing Kennedy. And the Discovery Channel contacted me because this show, Hard to Kill, what he does is they take him and put him in these really, really difficult situations, where he'll explain it, where they try to kill him. Or it's a situation that would be very difficult to survive, and the only reason he can survive is the show hires all these experts to teach them how to survive what it is he's going through. And so they were pitching me on this show, and they wanted to hire me as a freediving expert. And they were talking about what they were going to do is they were going to have it in this, he was going to be on the ship, and it was going to be sinking, and he was going to have to rescue someone, and who was unconscious, and the boat was going to be on fire, and then he was going to have to free dive down to get to the flares and the EPIRB and all this stuff, right? And so they contacted me, and they wanted me to train him in the pool and kind of do static apnea, right? Because they're like, oh, we heard that you can teach people to hold their breath a long time. And I'm like, yeah. So you have to understand, I get a lot of weird phone calls from people that want to do, they say they want to do movies, but like, I don't know. So when people call me on this kind of stuff, I kind of am just like, uh-huh. I remember the last time I had someone that called me and they wanted to do some movie and because they're all trying to make it like they're a really big deal. And I'm like, oh yeah, it's going to, be carried, blah, 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 blah. And then the last group, this was not the Discovery one, but the one before that. And I was like, it sounded a little bogus. And then after, I'm like, well, when is it? What the hell is it? What are the dates? How many days do you need me for? And at some point they started saying stuff about, well, we could get you to film. I'm like, look, if you have some movie and you're going to let some guy you already talked to, like, film, like, you don't know what you're talking about. So anyway, I'm always hesitant when I get these people. And so when he first called, they didn't say, it was going to be airing on Discovery Channel. And so, I was kind of interested, but I was like, if you let me put him in a course, I can, like, turn him into a free dive. Like, I don't know, we ain't got time for that. Like, we just got a couple hours. I'm like, well, I really can't do much in a couple hours. I mean, I can teach him to, hold his breath for, 3 or 4 minutes. Like, oh yeah, that'd be great. All right. And so then there's kind of more back and forth. And I'm like, but guys, if I teach this guy to hold his breath for 3 minutes, that really has nothing to do with the stunt that he's going to do. Right. And so we kind of have this back and forth, and I'm talking to Kathy about it. And I'm like, Kathy, this makes no sense. Like, I'm going to teach this guy in a pool in a perfectly calm environment. I can teach him to hold his breath a long time. Like, there's no question I can do that. But then he's going to be, in this totally chaotic environment, running around this boat, is going to be on fire, and he's got to carry unconscious guy off the boat. He's going to free. I'm like, it doesn't translate. Like, it's not really going to be the same. And Kathy's like, you need to quit working so hard to not get on the Discovery Channel. Like, this is the Discovery Channel. Like, not some like YouTube video. Like, you need to make this happen. Officially, I called them. I'm like, absolutely. Like, we put him in the pool. I'll teach him hold his breath. It's a super long time. It'd be awesome. And so they booked the show. So I got to teach Tim Kennedy, which was really cool. He was unlike any student I've ever had. he was definitely high energy. He was up. He was throwing the crew members in the pool, body slamming them in the pool. Some guy walked through the pool that wasn't supposed to, and he like asked me if he wanted me to go punch him in the throat. I'm like, yeah, we don't need to punch him in the throat. But he was a lot of fun. He was a super cool guy. He just was definitely super high energy. But anyway, they aired the show, and I told all my friends I was gonna be on the Discovery Channel, and I'm watching the show, and it was like, it's a 60-minute show. And it was like 59 minutes, and I wasn't on there. I was on there for probably 5 seconds. Maybe that might have been generous, but I was on there for just a little bit. But it doesn't matter. I can always say, as seen on Discovery Channel, which I have on my website in lots of places. So, if it wasn't for Kathy, I would have probably talked myself off that show. All right. All right, so one of my newer courses that I've gotten, and again, you can access here at the online freedomcourses.com, is the Breath Hold Secrets program, right? So in order to access that course, you would go here, and then once you click on the Get This Now, it's going to it's going to take you to the next page. And when you look at the next page, it's this, right? It's the Breath Hold Secrets Program, right? So this is the biggest, let me turn this off for now. Breath Hold Secrets Program is basically the biggest secret that you're going to learn in holding your breath, right? So the idea is, you talk to anyone taking a freediving course, they can all run their mouth about how excited they are they held their breath so much longer, right? And why? Because in a freediving course, you're going to learn the biggest secret to holding your breath, which is, it's not what you do during the breath hold, it's what you do before the breath hold, right? And so once you prepare properly, holding your breath is in fact quite simple, right? So that's what you're going to learn in the Breath Holding Secrets Program. And in the program, not only do you get Breath Hold Secrets, you're going to get access to the safety program. In fact, you have to go through the safety program first and get 100% on the quiz. Then you're going to get access to the TED Talks Freediving Greatest Hits, which is my old show that I used to do on Instagram. I got 20 episodes. There's about 20 hours. And I know you don't want to watch me talk for 20 minutes or 20 hours. So I got an instructor to watch all that, and he pulled out the best hour. So it's the best 1 hour of the 20 hours of the TED Talk show, and you're going to get access to the how to access your most primal reflex, which is the mammalian dive reflex, like what it is and how to make it work for you. And then lastly, get an interview with a good friend of mine, Ashley Futral Chapman, three-time world record holder, and I think it says 18, but I think it's 16 national records, but she just got some more, so maybe it is 18 now. All right, that's $39, and you can get that at the website right there, onlinefreedomcourses.com. Okay, so let's go over the main thing we were going to talk about, which is lung squeezes. Now, for those of you that are watching, after I go over the lung squeezes, I'm going to have time for Q&A. So if you guys have questions for me, please put them in the comments. I'm also curious if you have taken a formal freediving class, yes or no. But yeah, if you have questions, put them in the comments. And I always tell people, look, I mean, unless your roommate is a freediving instructor with 10 years of experience, you probably, this is a good chance to get access to someone that has a good amount of experience. So if you have questions, put them in the comments. And don't get upset if I don't answer them immediately, because I'm not gonna, but I will at the end. I have the ability to go through and look through all the comments that happened during the show, and I will answer your questions. All right, so let's talk about lung squeezes. Ah, yes, of course Spirit Magazine is taking a course. Twice. So that's Jeremy Gamble, owner of Spirit Magazine. He's gone through, he went, God, that was many, 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 many years ago. Did a private course at his house. Oh my God, that was really funny. That article was really funny. We did a private course at his house, and then a couple years later, he came down and did a course with me a couple years later. All right, so lung squeeze. Well, what is a lung squeeze? Well, so lung squeeze is, in essence, it's an injury, not surprisingly, to your lungs. And there's two main types. There is a lung squeeze, we're actually damaging the lungs. And then there's what, then there is another type that's, I think, kind of the more common type. Which is a tracheal squeeze, right? Where you're actually damaging the trachea, and it's not the lungs, but it's trachea. A lot of people don't understand the difference, but we'll be going over that. All right, so we'll talk about how to tell if you have one in a little bit, but it's going to be because you're, in essence, coughing up blood, and there's different variations of that. But let's talk about, so basically it's damage to the lungs, right? You're damaging the lung tissue, which is causing you to spit up blood, or you're causing a tear in the trachea, which again causes you to spit up blood. And we'll get into more of those, the mechanics behind that in a bit. The first thing I want to talk about is what's causing these lung squeezes and how you can avoid it. The most common cause of a tracheal squeeze, absolutely the most common in my opinion, is something that almost all freedivers, all spearfishermen do, basically until they take a freediving course. And what I mean by that is the average freediver, the average spear fisherman, if they were descending down to the bottom, right, they would be doing it going like this, right? So they'd be looking at the bottom of the ocean, right? If they're in the pool, they'd be seeing the bottom of the pool. If they're in the ocean, they're seeing the sand, they're seeing the reef on the way down, right? So they are, instead of looking in a head neutral position, they have their head cranked and they're looking where they're going, okay? That is very common. And that is one of the biggest reasons people get lung squeezes, and most of these are going to cause tracheal squeezes. But so let's talk about why that happens. So if you listen to the sound of my voice, you may have even already noticed it when I did that before. But when I had my head like this, and I'm like, and then they're looking at the sand, you hear my voice sounds all funny. And then when I look it back like this, it sounds totally normal again. But when I look where I'm going, it sounds all funny, right? So the reason my voice sounds all funny like that is my trachea, right, is about this big. Okay? Trachea is, it's like, it's semi-flexible, right? So, I mean, it's got a little bit of flex to it, but not a lot. Right, so if my trachea is this big, and then I look where I'm going, I'm increasing the length of that trachea, right? So if you take something that's not very flexible, and then you to it, right, you increase its length, can you understand that that's going to decrease the flexibility of that thing? Yeah, right, absolutely it is, right? So when you look where you're going, you're stretching out your trachea, which is reducing its flexibility, which means you're more likely to get a squeeze, right, in the trachea, which is going to cause, that's going to cause a tear in that trachea, which is going to then, you're going to notice that as you feel like your cough up tastes a little funny taste in your mouth because copper, which is out of blood, from that looking where you're going. It's also exacerbated by another problem, is if you look where you're going and you're going down, right, sometimes, especially if you're going maybe a little too deep than you're used to, if you know what a contraction is, you feel a contraction. A contraction is your diaphragm actually pulling down, right? So your diaphragm is pulling down, and then you're pulling it up, and so you get this, right? And so, again, more likely to get lung and tracheal squeezes from looking where you're going. So that's why in almost every single freediving class out there, they're going to tell you on day one, you got to quit going down like this and you want to start going down like this, right? Neutral head position, right? You should be, right? If you're going in the pool, you shouldn't see the bottom of the pool. You should see the sides of the pool, right? If you're going down in the ocean, you should not see the bottom. Bottom down here, you should be looking like this, right? If you're in a freediving class, you would be seeing the line the whole time, right? You would never see the plate, right? We want to have good head position. In my dreamland, my perfect freediving class world, I would, and I can't do it here because I live in a homeowners association, so I have limitations of what I can do. But if I lived in a house that where I was not in a homeowners association, I would make a badass pool, right? It would be super deep and, not super deep, it'd be 18 foot, right? That would be awesome. Or, okay, that's probably gonna get too out of hand. Maybe it'd be just 12 foot, right? But 15, whatever, but definitely, you know, have a deep end, right? My pool is like 7 foot right now, so it's not good for freediving classes. But what I would absolutely do is I would paint on the bottom a bunch of like pink unicorns and fuzzy buttons, butt bunnies. And on the sides, I would paint like hogfish and lobster and wahoo, right? So I get all the spearfishermen, like when you dive down, don't see the pink unicorns. You should see the lobsters. You should see the wahoo. And they would never look at the bottom again, right? They'd all be looking at all the fish on the side, right? But since I don't own a pool, I can't do that. Nate, you own a pool, so maybe you should consider doing that. All right, so the number one thing is one of the most common reasons that you get a lung squeeze is from looking where you're going. Okay, second reason people tend to get lung squeezes is especially when they're deeper than what they're kind of used to, is unnecessary movement, right? So, for instance, like a competitive freediver who's deep, we want to avoid any turning, stretching like this, right? You know, you see a lot of freedivers, they'll grab the line and they'll reach like this to grab the plate. And why that's efficient and that they don't have to go all the way to the depth, right? Because they're also cranking all of this, the rib cage and all this stuff, right? And so they're really putting a lot of strain on this and you got all that pressure and you're compressed, right? It's going to increase the likelihood for having a squeeze, right? So, for instance, if you're a line or a competitive diver, you really want to minimize those chest movements, right? So what I try to do is if I'm down really deep and I'm worried about that, I have like a on purpose really bad form. So at some point I've got my hands dropped, my shoulders are hunched. I'm trying to just be as compressible as I can. And I'll probably not be able to explain this on the screen, but I just hold this position. And then when I get near the plate, I just grab the line because I'm sinking. I'm not even kicking. I just grab the line like this, and then I just allow my momentum to like flop me over. And so I'm basically not moving. I'm just holding on the line. I kind of go, and then I flop over, and then I plop the tag, and then I drop my hands and I just try to kick up like that, right? So I'm trying to minimize any of that, right? So for spear fishermen, one thing you definitely want, I actually had someone tell me to do, when I first started freediving, they told me to do this. A good friend of mine who was a scuba instructor who was way more advanced than me, and so he had read some Maui book about freediving. He told us that when you get down, when you're underwater, you want to stretch like this, and that does something to your rib cage and your lungs, and it opens them up, and it makes you, yeah, no, you don't, we absolutely don't want to be doing any stretching like this underwater. That's absolutely going to increase your risk. Especially when you get down to depth, you really want it. There's no reason you want to be arching the back, arching this. And it's especially a spear fisherman, because when you're going down, you're going to be going into this position, right? And so you want to be careful and make that as smooth as possible. I definitely know spear fishermen who have squeezed themselves, from cranking the head, doing all this sort of stuff. So just something to be aware of. You just want to minimize motions. What I would see from a class environment is, so it's very rare that a student would get a lung squeeze. Extremely, extremely rare. But there's times when a student had a squeeze, and I know exactly why, and I can see it's because that frantic movement, right? They get down to the plate, maybe it's 80 feet, 100 feet, or 130 feet, whatever the hell it is, and they ain't comfortable, right? And you just see that they touch the plate, and they're just jerking themselves around, and they're throwing their hands up, and just everything is just super hectic, right? And especially when you're at those deeper depths, any of that hectic motion is going to increase your risk for having a lung or tracheal squeeze. So, you should be, even at depth, you should be relaxed, right? If you're at depth and you are not relaxed, right, you're definitely too deep, and you need to, what you need to do is you need to go through my 28-day program and learn how to do all the stretches that I teach, right, so that you can become more relaxed at depth, right? You should feel, when you're at depth, you want to feel relaxed. If you're not, it's because you're not flexible enough. You got to do your diaphragm stretches, lung stretches, all that sort of stuff. But anyway, so which goes to the other reason you're going to get a lung squeeze is when you're, and this is definitely more in the competitive environment, line diving environment, but really doesn't, it's just spear fishing, whatever, is when you're diving deeper than you're accustomed to, right? If you're an 80-foot diver and that's like your comfortable zone, and for whatever reason, you're going to decide to do a dive to 120, 130 feet, right? That's way deeper than what you're used to. And so that can lead to, when you're diving deeper than what you're used to, that's going to increase the risk, because you're going to feel uncomfortable. You're going to have really strong, hard contractions. You're not going to be calm and relaxed like I'm talking about, because you're diving deeper than you're used to and you haven't gone through all the stretching and done all the stuff you're supposed to be doing. Diving deeper than you are used to is going to increase the risk. Another reason that will increase your risk of getting a lung or tracheal squeeze is by not doing a good warm-up, right? Again, any freediving class, you can see most freediving competitors are gonna do something called pull-downs, right? Where they go down to, they pull down the line, right? Not kicking their feet, and they sit there at 15 feet for, a minute, 2 minutes, they work their way back up, and they do it again to 30 feet, and then you do it again to 50 feet, right? And these slow pull-downs, right? They allow your mammalian dive reflex to kick in. They lower your heart rate. All these amazing things happen. And that's why another thing that we do that reduces the risk of lung squeezes. Certainly, pull downs and these warm-ups are not common at all among spear fishermen, right? And so if you're a spear fisherman, and yeah, you might be able to spearfish at 80 foot, after maybe an hour's worth of diving, you can do that. As most spear fishermen, they start shallow and they work their way down. So they're in essence trying to warm themselves up. They're just doing it it takes a lot longer to do it than the way that we do it. But just because you're, an 80-foot spear fisherman, if you just jump off the boat and try to bomb down to 80 foot, right, that's going to be hard for most people because you're not warmed up. And then it's that type of dive that's going to increase risk of having a lung or tracheal squeeze. Now, but the bottom line is it's being relaxed. People are always shocked that when they do things right, they can get really deep and they feel relaxed, right? They can't ever believe that would happen. But if you do everything right, that's what will happen. All right, so how do you know if you have one? All this talk about one, well, what do you know if you have one, right? So the most obvious way, and it's normally pretty obvious, you'd come up from a dive. And so we've got different classifications of squeezes. We class one as type one, type two, and type three. So some of you that are, I know I see I got a lot of old students in the class. PFI has added a type three squeeze. So most of you people in here probably only heard me talk about level one, level two. And I'm sure you remember all the details. But level one squeeze would be you come up to the surface, you know, you feel fine, right? You know, but you notice after you're at the surface for a while, maybe you feel a little tickle in the throat and it makes you kind of go like that. And then if you were to cough into your hand, you would notice that it's almost all spit and you see little flecks of kind of red spots, right? And so that's blood. And so we would classify that as a minor squeeze or a type one squeeze. So if you were to have that, you would spend 2 weeks out of the water, 1 week out of the water, but I would just recommend two no matter what, but 1 or 2 weeks out of the water. And if that happened on an 80-foot dive, or let's say happened on a 100-foot dive, you would come back at 50% of the depth, right? So if that happened on a 100-foot dive, you would take 2 weeks off, and then you would come back at 50 foot. And then you would start, you'd only stay at 50 foot that entire day, right? And the next day you came out, if you wanted to drop it, you could drop it 15 feet, right? Maybe like 65 feet, right? The idea is you want to make slow, small increments to depth, right? You don't want to do one day at 50 foot, be like, oh, I felt good, and then bomb yourself down to 100 feet. Because squeezing, when you get a squeeze, right? When you get a tracheal squeeze or a lung squeeze, especially for tracheal squeezes, you're going to get, like I've had both, right? I've had a tracheal squeeze and I know right where it is. It's right here, right? If I could stick my finger down my throat and not gag myself, I could put right where it is, right? And when you have that, you're going to have scar tissue that grows over that, right? And this is going to heal up fine. Because it's a cut, that's where the blood's coming from. So it's going to heal over with scar tissue, but that scar tissue is not as strong, right, as what was there before. So guess what? When you get a squeeze, especially a tracheal squeeze, more likely to re-squeeze in the exact same spot, right? So that's why it's really critical to take the time off and work your way back slowly, right? So I know of just countless, I could bore you to death with all the stories I've heard of competitive freedivers. They get that, like, they want to get deep and they're fired up and they're trained and they get squeezed and they're supposed to take 2 weeks off, but they don't. And they get squeezed again and again and again and again and again. And they keep having all these reasons why they shouldn't have to do those things. And they do what I call it squeezing themselves out of the sport. They just get squeezed shallower and shallower and shallower and shallower, right? It's because they're not following those rules, right? So you definitely want to take squeezes seriously because you can absolutely make it so you can no longer dive again, right? Let's be clear. Spitting up blood after dives ain't normal. You were doing something wrong, okay? Now, that's a type one squeeze, which basically means if you were to spit into the hand, you would see mostly spit little flecks of blood. Now, when I say spit into the hand, I've definitely had some students really freaked out. Have you ever noticed, maybe on a dive, if you've ever had a sinus squeeze, if you know what a sinus squeeze are, you would notice that, you know, they're going to have blood coming out of the nose, right? So I've had students cough into the hand, there's blood's everywhere, and they're like, oh my God, I've lung squeeze. And I'm like, no, it's coming out of your nose, right? You've got a sinus squeeze. Right, so if you're gonna spit into the hand, there's basically two ways you could do that. I could spit from down here, and that would be coming from here, or I could go, and that would be bring it from up here. Right, so when you're gonna spit in the hand and do this, pull it up from the chest, like that, now, and like that. All right, so make sure it's coming from the chest, but that's how you would tell. Now, a type two squeeze. Now you spit into the hand and you see, type two squeeze, you're going to, you spit into the hand and you see more blood than spit, right? I don't need to tell you that that's not good, right? I mean, you shouldn't be and then having blood come out, right? So that's what we call a type 2 squeeze, 2 weeks out. And again, coming back at 50% depth, right? So type 1 squeeze, you would take 1 week off. Type 2 squeeze, you would take 2 weeks off. You have a type 2 squeeze where you're spitting up blood, right? You need to talk to someone, right? I mean, like, you need to talk to your freediving instructor or me or a doctor or something. You shouldn't, that is not normal, right? I would tell you that that coughing a big whack of blood like that, that is mostly, in my experience, a competitive freediver thing. I'm not sure I'm really ever aware of anyone having something like that happen, like just on a recreational, you know, normal dive. Type 1 squeeze, absolutely, right? But you're whacking up whacks of blood. That's something's definitely wrong. Now, we've got a type 3 squeeze. So type 3 squeeze is obviously worse. So a couple things that make it different is a type 3 squeeze is you'd be coughing the minute you hit the surface, right? Immediately upon surface, you'd be coughing. We'd see blood. There would be possibly cyanosis, blueness of the lips, right? Which is meaning that even though you're at the surface breathing, your body, the lungs are so damaged that you're basically hypoxic even though you're at the surface breathing, right? So you would see blueness of the lip, shortness of breath. And in a situation like that, absolutely, you're getting put on O2, right? That's one of the reasons you should have pure O2. So pure O2 until that hypoxic goes away, till the lips go away, or till your breathing goes back to normal. So if that's happening with type 3 squeeze, you're out to 4 to 8 weeks, right? So a good time off. You have to take that time away to let everything heal. And then same thing, 50% depth, and then working your way down nice and slow. Now, one thing that we'll say is if you get a type 1 squeeze where you just a teeny bit of blood, right? And you're supposed to take a week off. You take a week off and you do it again and you just sort of a little bit of blood, right? You're like, ah, it's just a little bit of blood, it's no big deal, right? What we'll tell you is if you get re-squeezed again, especially in a short amount of time, that's really bad because that means you're re-injuring that same thing and you are about to start going down that cycle where you start getting squeezed shallower and shallower and shallower, right? Which you do not want, right? And I've seen, so I get emails from people, I see it on posts, I talk to the people and they just, they're like, but I keep squeezing. They keep thinking, well, if I just do this. But what they never do is take the time off, which is what's causing it. So if you were to even get a level 1 squeeze, a little squeeze, and then you took a week off and then got squeezed again, we would immediately reclassify that as a type 3 squeeze, meaning you got to take 4 to 8 weeks off, right? Because we're trying to say if you're getting re-squeezed, you need more rest. And then if you get re-squeezed on a type 3, right, you do that one again, right, then we say 4 months, right? If you're getting cyanosis, you're getting squeezed that terribly, right, and you do that again, right, you need to take a break from freediving. So PFI recommends 4 months. Okay, so that's basically it with squeezes. So I'm going to go through and answer some of your questions. What I'll tell you, if you enjoy that, if you learned something from that, do me a favor, hit the like button and think about any questions you have. And I don't know if there are questions or not. I haven't read them yet, but I'll go through and look at that, and then we'll go over questions. All right, so I'm going to go through and pull up all the old comments. Just bear with me. Let's see. Well, Andy, if you are still here, this is a good place to learn a lot about freediving. All right, so I got a couple questions. All right, so a couple questions, and then I will wrap this thing up. Okay, so for those of you that don't know, the program I'm most excited about, the best program that I have, is my 28-day freediving transformation program, right? So what I'm always asking people is, I say, look, would you want to be able to dive deeper? And they always go, yes, Ted. I said, would you like to feel more comfortable and confident at depth and not feel panicked? And they always go, yes, Ted. I say, would you like to increase your bottom time? And they always go, yeah. They always say yes. They never say no. And then I say, well, what are you currently doing to achieve those results? And the answer is always, well, I go diving wherever I can, right? Which is not specific and targeted training, right? That's just, you know, I'm going to go diving and I hope I get better, right? Athletes don't work that way. There's not any sport where the person's not serious about their sport where they don't do specific and targeted training, right? Spear fishermen and recreational freedivers don't know squat about how to train for freediving. And you know how to train, you know what group of freedivers know how to train for freediving? Competitive freedivers. We can dive crazy deep, we can hold our breath a crazy long time, and we can stay down there forever. Why? Not because we're merman, it's because we do specific and targeted training, right? And so that's what my 28-day freediving transformation program does. It is going to give you the 5 most effective and time efficient ways that you can exercise train at home, like where you're sitting right now. You do not need to go to the ocean. You do not need to go to the pool. You don't have to get the buddy. You don't get the approval from the lifeguard, right? You can do this training at home. Okay. I'm going to give you a workout. I mean, I'm going to lay everything out. You're going to get a calendar. You're going to stick it on the refrigerator. I'm going to tell you what to do on what days. You're going to do 3 breath hold training, 3 breath holds a week. Each one is a different type of exercise. Every exercise is going after a different weakness. So you've got 2 of them, which you are not going to enjoy. They kind of hurt. They're difficult. And then the other one, and this is the one that I designed, and I think I've had so much feedback on this. This is my personal exercise that I've had so many people say is their best part of it, is the best part of the program. And it's actually an easy one. It's actually an easy breath hold, right? So you're going to hold your breath and it's going to be easy. But I think it's very important because it teaches you how to learn to minimize and relax and delay your contractions. I've had so many people say that that was their favorite part of the program, right? So it's 3 breath hold training exercises. And so that takes about 30 to 45 minutes at a time, right? So that's 3 days. You're going to do about 30, 45 minutes. And then the other 2 days, you're just going to do 5 minutes worth of stretching, right? So it's basically 5 days a week. It's 2 hours a week. You do that for 28 days, right? One of the guys in here, Nate, he gave me a video testimonial, and he said, if you follow what's in Ted's program, it's impossible for you not to improve, right? There's no way you could not improve because you're going through the proven freediving training, right? Most people just don't know what to do. They just maybe hold their breath on the couch 2 days in a row. They're like, well, that sucked, and it doesn't help at all because they don't know what they're doing. So that's the 28-day program. I'll show you. The 28-day program is... So the 28-day program. Oh, did I make it so you guys can see this? Yes. The 28-day program. So you're going to get access to the 28-day freediving program. You're going to get the calendar, which you could always say you stick on the refrigerator, you mark your progress, and that way every time you go to your fridge and you get a beer or a bonbon, you're reminded you're supposed to do something. You're supposed to do that and not have beer and bonbons. So you get access to the 28-day program. You also get access to Breath Hold Secrets, which is the other program that I was talking about earlier. It's $39. It's included in this program. You're going to get access to Noob Spearow's 99 Spearfishing Tips ebook, so you're going to get that included. If you're a spear fisherman, this is a must-have. This is the only place you can get this. This is an interview with Jeremy Gamble, owner of Spearing Magazine, and he basically went through my course, and the interview discusses how he implemented the safe freediving he learned with me into his spearfishing. So how to spearfish and still be safe and implement all the stuff you learned in my program. So this is a super cool interview. You also get access to a private Facebook group where you can ask me directly questions, and the students post their workouts every day and encourage each other. So that's kind of cool. And then also you get the freediving safety course, which you have to go through and pass the quiz and get 100% before you can access the program. All right. So that's the deal. So that is, $95. I'll put a coupon code in here when I shut down the show. It'll take probably 10 minutes to put it up, but I'll take $15 off the price of the course. It'll be $80, and that coupon code will be good for 24 hours. So basically until Tuesday night. All right, so there were a couple questions in here, and I'm going to try to go through and answer these. Marcial Suarez, you asked this question on the forum and I answered it, so I guess you weren't watching. So I'll answer it again. So he's asking, this is a student of the 28-day program, and he's asking, after finishing the 28-day program, what would be the routine to do? So I got two answers to your question. Number one, just continue. Just continue doing it, right? You can maybe be a little lazier with it because, maybe do two breaths. I mean, if you just continue it, it's going to keep working. But the main thing is your diaphragm reflex is tuned in, so you can maybe just do two breath holds a week. And just pick whichever one you wanted or cycle it around. I mean, the best thing to do is just be completely repeat, but you may want to take a break. But the thing I will tell you is I have in here the program for the next 28 days. And the next 28-day program is going to be completely different than the first one because the first one is designed to get your base, right? So the second one, we already got that, and now we're going a completely different direction. So I have it in here. I just haven't blah, blah, blah it into the camera and the course and all that stuff. I got to go do some filming to do it because I can't do it here. But that course will be, at some point, I'll have that. And that will be the best thing you need to do is take the next 28-day program. Okay? All right. So that was that question. So Ferdinand asked, do I recommend O2 tables 3 times a week plus max breath hold? How is the best way to achieve schedule the max breath hold? The best way to do that is sign up for my 28-day program, and I'm going to outline everything into the highest level of detail that you could ever imagine, right? So that would be what I recommend, is go through the 28-day program and follow exactly what I said in there. All right, let me see. Other questions. What do we got? Nate, I'm not aware of tracheal stretches preventing tracheal squeeze. I'll just be honest, it's not something I know much of anything about, so I'm not going to talk about it. Sarah, I'm glad you learned a lot from watching the videos. I have tons and tons of them. Octavia, breathing out of the nose is I wouldn't say it's nothing to worry about, but it's not nearly as severe as a lung or tracheal squeeze. It is probably, I mean, it's hard to tell what it would be, but it's most common blood out of the nose is from a sinus squeeze, is the most common reason that is happening. All right, so looks like I went through and was able to answer all the questions. Yes, Nate, you actually, considering that your students are all, many of your students are mermaids, they probably do think you're a merman. All right, so I'm going to wrap this puppy up. I will be back, not tomorrow, I've got plans tomorrow night, but I'll be back Wednesday, and I'll be doing it on Thursday. The show on Wednesday will be covering how to rescue your buddy from a lost mojo or blackout. Might as well be a video instruction on how to, if your buddy has a blackout, what the heck are you supposed to do? Yes, Jeremy, I've got... I got to get this sorted first, but absolutely. What was I saying? So Wednesday we're doing, I'm doing one on how to rescue someone from a blackout. And then on Thursday, I'm going to get, explain why, because I get a lot of questions on this. Is people, you know, they've heard about freediving courses or maybe they've seen stuff. They always need to ask, why do we blow across people's eyeballs when they black out, right? So I'm going to get into why we do that. So yeah, so that'll be the plan. So if you guys enjoyed the show, here's the single best thing you do want. If you haven't hit the like button, right, because that lets Facebook know that you like this and they show it to more people. The second thing is if you enjoy the show, want to support what I do, share this video, right? And I'm going to get specific, right? If you hit the share button, don't get me wrong, that's awesome. But when you hit the share button, that's all you do. Basically, your friends see a picture of me going blah, 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 and blah down their page, right? And they're like, who the hell is that guy? What's he talking about? And they don't really care. Right. If you take the time when you hit the share button to say, hey, guys, if you're a freediver, if you're a spear fisherman, you should check out this show. Right. Because they don't know me. I'm just another face flying down their screen yapping at them. They don't know me, but they know you. And if you say that this show is worth watching, they might check it out. Right. So I would ask you, if you want to know how to help me, share it and then say something about the show. Tell them why they should tune in and listen. That's the single best thing you can do to support the show. All right, so I will be back Wednesday and Thursday, 7 p.m. As always, dive safe out there. It's not even that hard, especially when you can go to freedivingsafety.com and learn everything about how to not kill yourself and be safe for free. All right, see you guys.